Good morning. Welcome to Reformed Presbyterian Church. It's a delight to see all of you on this, the first Sunday of May. Can you believe we've made it to May? The first Sunday of the month, we do a few things slightly differently here. For one, we have Amen Bingo in the back for the kids to enjoy, so you can head back there and grab a sheet if you haven't done so already. Also, as you can see in the front, we celebrate the Lord's Supper traditionally on the first Sunday of each month, so we are delighted to do that later in our service as well. This is the day that the Lord has made, and God's people all across the world gather this morning to worship the one true God. Here we gather in person and online to worship the Lord together, to encourage one another, and as one voice, worship him, lift his name high. So let's begin our worship this morning with a responsive reading from Psalm 34, which you can find in your bulletin as well as on the screen behind me. From Psalm 34. I will extol the Lord at all times. His praise will always be on my lips.
My soul will boast in the Lord. Let the afflicted hear and rejoice.
Whoever of you loves life and desires to see many good days, keep your tongue from evil and your lips from speaking lies.
Turn from evil and do good. Seek peace and pursue it.
Taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who takes refuge in him.
Glorify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together.
Let's pray together. O Lord, our God, as we gather here this morning, help us to see your face. May we indeed taste and see that you are good, and all blessing and all life comes from you. Oh Lord, may we be singularly focused on you this morning, that your name may be lifted high in this place and in our hearts and in our minds. You alone, Lord, reign on high. We pray, Lord, in Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you.
Please remain standing as we confess our faith from the Apostles' Creed. Christian, what do you believe?
Thank you. For where you have envy and selfish ambition, there you find disorder and every evil practice. But the wisdom that comes from heaven is first of all pure, then peace-loving, considerate, submissive, full of mercy and good fruit, impartial and sincere. Peacemakers who sow in peace raise a harvest of righteousness.
We do want to welcome all of you to our service this morning. It's good to have you with us on this Lord's Day. There are slips of paper in the bulletin, and if you're visiting with us, if you'd be so kind as to fill one of those out and place it in the offering plates, which are at the rear of the sanctuary, then we'd have a way of just to greet you in a further way. You won't be put on a mailing list for the rest of your life, we promise. but we are glad for your presence here today. If you have any questions about our church, could be your first time here, we'd be happy to talk to you about that. If you would turn in your Bibles to Colossians chapter 3, reading this morning from verses 12 through 15. And our focus today is going to be on verse 15, which is the last of those verses. Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other and forgive whatever grievances you may have against one another. Forgive as the Lord forgave you. And over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts. As members of one body, you are called to peace and be thankful. This is God's word to us today. Now, we've been decelerating a little bit in the book of Colossians as we've come across some pretty substantial teachings that are said in very few words. We just completed a sort of a four-part series that had Easter and Palm Sunday in between on forgiveness, simply from verse 13, where we're told to bear with each other, forgive whatever grievances you may have against one another, forgive as the Lord forgave you. So we looked at that, and we kind of went sideways into the rest of scriptures to fill that picture out. Next week, and actually the following 3 weeks, we're going to be looking at gratitude, which is mentioned several times in the space of very few verses. We'll be looking at what does it mean to do things in the name of the Lord, to bear his name. And we'll be looking at what it means to have the word of Christ dwell in us richly, and that in the context of worship, which involves singing and making music in our hearts. So that's kind of where we're headed. But today, we come to this teaching in verse 15, which says to us, let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body, you are called to peace. And that's our focus for this morning. If we were to take a survey within the Ephrata community or the larger part of our county and ask the question, what is peace and how do you achieve that? I'm sure we would get a variety of answers. Given the fact that we are Americans, probably 75% of the people we talk to would define peace as an inner peace, something that we feel inside of our beings. Others would choose to define peace negatively, like, well, peace is the absence of hostility. It's the absence of conflict in relationships. I'm sure there are some who would define peace as the universal brotherhood of man to be ushered in by our innate goodness within all of us. Of course, we're still waiting for that after how many thousands of years of history. When you transfer this word peace into the international setting, the realm of politics or international relations, the definition gets even more confusing. Some would say that peace must come through strength, through intimidation. And if you don't have that, there won't be peace. One of our presidents in the previous century kind of talked about the big stick that we should have as a country to sort of allow for peace to prosper around the world. But that comes through strength. Others would say that peace comes through disarmament, mutual weakness, vulnerability. Give peace a chance. Some people define peace as when everybody stops, that one moment in history when everybody stops to reload. That seems to be true. Others would say, you know, peace comes through isolation. So let's have very little to do with other nations and, you know, just stay out of everyone else's business, and then perhaps there will be peace. My question for you this morning is, how does the Bible define peace? When the world talks about peace and the scriptures talk about peace, they're talking about two entirely different things. So let me just give you a quick survey of how the Bible speaks of this. Okay, I'll give you four ways in which the scriptures talk about this. Number one, there is the peace that belongs to God himself, to God alone. It's part of his character. It's part of his nature. 1 Corinthians 14:33, for God is not a God of disorder, but of peace. 2 Thessalonians 3:16, now may the Lord of peace himself give you peace. Gideon, who was one of the judges in the Old Testament, built an altar to the Lord, and he named the altar, "The Lord is Peace." Isaiah refers to Jesus as the Prince of Peace. In Micah 5:5, we read that the Savior will come and shepherd his flock, and he himself will be our peace. That's because God is peace. He's not only holy and just and loving and righteous, but he is peace. God doesn't need peace. He is peace in his very nature. Second way in which peace is used is of mankind having peace with God. The peace that God establishes between himself and believers. Romans 5:1. Therefore, since you have been justified or declared righteous through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. This is the peace which God makes with us through the blood of Jesus on the cross. It's the peace that's being restored, which was lost in Adam and Eve, our first parents, when they rebelled against the Lord. One of the central messages of the Bible is that there is no natural peace with God. We are not born into it. Man is not born in a natural state of peace with his maker. And so it's our responsibility as his creatures, the one made by the Creator, to move towards God and to seek peace with God. I'll tell you what does come naturally, and that's rebellion. Conflict, sin. I said last week in the series on forgiveness, you know, we don't have to teach our children how to have conflict or to say, hey, that's mine, give it to me, or to not respond with revenge or retaliation. We all know those things coming out of the womb. What we do need to learn is love and righteousness and peace, and that only comes from God. Every person on this earth is born alienated from God. All have sinned and fallen short of his glory. The heart of man, we could say, is at war with God and wants independence from him in its sinful state. That's only half the message, though. The good news of the scripture is that while we were yet sinners, while we were yet at war with God, God, who is peace in his very nature, Christ came and died for us. Paul already referred to that in Colossians chapter 1, the letter that we're studying, where he says in verse 19, God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in Christ and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through his blood shed on the cross. So there's not just the peace of God's nature, there is the peace that God establishes through Christ. Third kind of peace is the peace with which God fills us. This is not only the peace that belongs to God or peace with God, but the peace of God that is within us. It's an inner peace. Romans 15, verse 13. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace. And that's, he's talking about a peace that's in here. It's a peace that lies deep within. It's a peace that keeps our hearts still or stable in the midst of great pressure and anxiety. Paul says that prayer gives us this renewed sense of peace. Philippians 4:7 tells us that if we lift our anxieties to God in prayer, that the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. The fourth kind of peace in the scriptures, in the broadest sense of this teaching, it's the peace of God with believers. The peace of God with those upon whom the grace of Christ has fallen. In the broadest sense of that teaching, we are called to live at peace with all men insofar as it depends on us. That's what Romans 12:18 tells us. Jesus said, "Blessed are the peacemakers, for they'll be called sons of God." But the narrower sense of this teaching is found in Colossians 3:15, our text for today, and that is that we are to live in peace with our fellow believers in the body of Christ. Paul says in Romans 14:19, "Let us therefore make every effort to do what leads to peace and mutual edification." And it's that kind of peace that I want to explore with you in the time that we have remaining today. What are we told in this passage about the peace between believers? What kind of peace is this? Well, for one thing, it is a peace to which we are called, okay? It's a calling. As members of one body, he says in verse 15, you were called to peace. What does that mean? Well, it means that because God is peace in his nature, and that he has in his grace established peace with us through forgiveness, that we are to, in turn, then reflect that grace and that forgiveness and that peace with our fellow believers. More importantly, behind this is the bond of peace that Christ created between believers through the cross. If you look in Ephesians chapter 2, just a few books back, from Colossians, in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 14, he says, But now in Christ Jesus, you who were once far away have been brought near through the blood of Christ, for he himself is our peace, who has made the two one and has destroyed the barrier or the dividing wall of hostility by abolishing that in his flesh. Isn't that what Paul is saying in a briefer form in the book that we're studying, Colossians chapter 3, in verse 11? He says, "Here there is no Jew or Greek, circumcised or uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave or free, but Christ is all and he is in all." What does that mean for the church? What does that mean for our relationships? Well, number one, kind of piggybacking on that verse that I just read, peace means that in the church and in the relationship with believers, there is no room for nationism or racism. There's just no room for that at all, because in Christ, there isn't any Jew or Greek or circumcised or uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave or free, but Christ is all and is in all. The Colossians and the Ephesians were having trouble in their churches, particularly between the Jewish people and the Gentiles, the people of the nations. And Ephesus was an international city, a place of trade, of crossroads, of access to the Mediterranean Sea. So there were people there from all over the world. And some of them were becoming believers in Christ. And even in Colossae, there are people from different nations as he writes to them. And what is he saying? He says, Jesus Christ has torn down those barriers. Those walls of hostility have been torn down in his flesh on the cross. It also means there's no room for class distinction. Like, well, there's the people who, you know, have a lot of money and they're very wealthy, and then there's people who are very poor, and so we separate as churches. Now, if you look across our country, it kind of seems like the American church in many ways is separated that way. It's not like someone has in mind, like, oh, okay, let's just worship with these kind of people, but it seems sometimes like it just works itself out that way. One of the things I enjoy about ministering at RPC is that we have people from all different kinds of backgrounds, all different kinds of education levels, all different kinds of employment, and we're different. But that's what makes ministry exciting. There's no room for class distinctions. I think of the Philippian church and the first three members of the Philippian church. First one was the, I won't go in the order of their conversion, but number one, you have a retired army officer from the Roman army who is the jailer in Philippi, and he becomes a believer. And then you have this slave girl, we aren't even told her name, she's being trafficked for her abilities, which are satanic, to predict the future, tell people what's going to happen. She may be a prostitute. And then you have a woman entrepreneur who's involved in the purple dye trade, which is a very, purple dye is extremely expensive. It's extracted from only certain kinds of shellfish. And so a woman who's involved in that kind of business is someone who, she is a person of means. She's wealthy. Now these are the charter members of the Philippian church. And Christ said, I'm going to build my church on that combination of people, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. Became Paul's most beloved congregation, if you read his epistles. There's no room for racism. There's no room for nationism. There's no room for class distinction. And by the way, there's no room for pride, petty controversies, or divisiveness. That's absolutely counter to all that the gospel stands for. And time again, Paul warns us about this. In all of his letters, and Peter warns us about it, and James warns us about it. Now, why is it in all the letters? Because everybody wrestles with it. We're all sinners, right? We just finished a series on forgiveness. We all need forgiveness, and we all need to give forgiveness, right? So those things will be present as we seek to grow in Christ. But our energy is to be devoted to peace. Make every effort, Ephesians 4:3, to maintain the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace, Romans 14:19. Therefore, let us make every effort to do what leads to peace. Hebrews 12:14, make every effort to live in peace with all men. Psalm 34, seek peace and pursue it. It's kind of like having to mow your lawn. We get a break in the winter up here in the north. But, you know, it's not like you went out and you mowed your lawn yesterday and now it's done. You're going to probably be mowing it, you know, a couple times a week until it gets drier and summer comes, but you kind of got to keep up with it. And peace is that way, okay? okay? It's not a once and for all thing, but we work on peace in our relationships. You work on peace in your marriage, okay? You work on peace in relationships within your small group. We're called to peace, and so therefore, as a church, we value peace. It is a high value. One of our membership vows is that we would pursue the purity and the peace of the church. And sometimes purity is sought after at the expense of peace. And sometimes peace is sought after at the expense of purity. And that's why we need to do both. That's why the psalmist says that righteousness and peace kiss each other. Both of those two things together. Notice, secondly, that this peace to which we are called is also a peace that must reign. Okay? It must rule. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, in your relationships. The word rule here literally means to function like an umpire. We have any umpires here?
No umpires. Any referees? No referees. Okay.
All right. Can you imagine watching an international soccer match, this World Cup, and there's no referees? The players are just going to police themselves? Okay. Can you imagine
watching a Major League Baseball game and they defunded the umpires. And so you have to decide whether it's a ball or strike. How much peace is there going to be on the field, okay, in the stadium? This is the word rule here is a verb from the athletic arena where the umpire settles disputes and calls the shots as if it were a contest. The umpire is there to keep order, to see that the game continues without disturbance or controversy, or if there is, there's someone who can settle that. And what the umpire or referee has to say goes because he's in charge. Okay? So what Paul is saying here is peace is in charge. Let the peace of Christ rule. Which means that God's peace is not passive, it is active. It's not like the sunbather at Ocean City who lies there in the sun all day getting their golden tan. It's a lot more like the lifeguard who is alert and always watching the swimmers in case there's a dangerous riptide or someone gets injured or someone's struggling and perhaps drowning. It's active, it's powerful, it's alert. That is the sense of Philippians 4:7, where Paul says, let the peace of God guard your minds and hearts in Christ Jesus. When the disciples were in that boat and the storm came on the Sea of Galilee and they were deathly afraid and they had to wake Jesus up, when they're a little bit angry, a little bit ticked off, like, Master, you know, what are you doing sleeping? We're about to die. They're very afraid. But you see, here's the point of that story, is that if Jesus is in the boat, you don't need to be afraid. Right? If Jesus is there, you don't have to be afraid. Which is to say, disciples, let it rule. Let the peace of Christ guard you. He is strong. He has saved you. He will take care of you. One of the problems in the 20th century church, 21st century church, also the 20th and before, is to privatize the fruit of the Spirit. We make them so inward and personal, as though the fruit of the Spirit, it's all like in here. Love, joy, peace, compassionness, gentleness, patience, all those things. But really the fruit of the Spirit are social fruits.
Because when it talks about being gentle, well, who are you being gentle to? It talks about love, who are you being loving to? When it talks about peace, it's not just talking about some feeling, it's talking about peace. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts. God gives us that inwardly to rule in our relationships, which is why we read earlier in our service that where you have envy and selfish ambition, then you're going to find disorder and all kinds of evil practices. But the wisdom that comes from God is first of all pure, and then peace-loving, considerate, submissive, full of mercy, good fruit, impartial and sincere. Peacemakers who sow in peace raise a harvest of righteousness. You know, this has been a really tough 13, 14 months. Okay, it's been tough for every church, I assume. And it's been a hard year for me as a pastor. It's challenged me in a lot of ways, exposed my weaknesses. I remember talking to Fred Thomas at one time, and Fred was saying, you know, there's just a little bit of COVID anger lying underneath everyone, including me, including Fred, including all of us, because we're all frustrated. But I want to commend you as a congregation. Okay? Because we don't all agree on everything that we're doing. Okay? The practices that we have put in place. But you have handled yourselves well. Can I just say that? Doesn't mean we agree on everything. Peace doesn't mean we agree on everything. But peace is how we handle ourselves and each other in the midst of when there is disagreement. And while it's been a hard year for all of us, you've been a good congregation. You have respected each other. We have sought to respect you. We have seen you being loving and kind and reasonable, even in maybe sharing what you disagree with, but you have done it well. And I want to thank you for that. I think you're practicing some of the things that we see here in this passage. Final thing is that peace is not just a calling, and peace is not just to rule or reign in our lives, but peace is a matter of the heart. It begins in the heart. There's no pill. I'm sure there's a pill you could take that would make you feel peaceful, but then you wouldn't hear the sermon, right? Okay. Peace begins in the heart. Jesus is in our hearts. The Holy Spirit's in our hearts. That's where it starts. And that's what he says, that the peace of Christ rule in your hearts. And out of that, you see, where the gospel is there, and out of that comes what we're called to, okay? It starts in the heart. The heart is the headquarters from which all the peace missions in life are launched. It's not something we can simply manufacture. It is of God. It's the fruit of the Spirit. And so when Paul says, let it rule in your hearts, what he's really talking about here is just the gospel being in charge of your life. Okay? The gospel being in charge of your life. It's talking about you believing in the gospel, and because you believe in the gospel, not as some moment back there when I believe, but because you continue to believe in the gospel, you continue to seek to let that govern your life and your actions. And of course, none of us do that perfectly, but that's why the Lord forgives us. What's the gospel? The gospel is that God, who is peace, has made peace with you, his people. He forgave all your sins. While you were yet sinners, he died for you. He bore the wrath of God on the cross, and in bearing that wrath, he turned that wrath aside in terms of what we deserved. Peace is that God has become your friend when you and I deserve to be his enemies. That's his peace. So let the gospel that's come into your life and forgiven you, let that rule your life, which means sometimes we really have to pay attention to our hearts because they get agitated. Yours does and mine does, okay? And we need to remind ourselves daily. It's like having three meals a day. How many times a day do we have to say, let the gospel rule in my life, rather than just, you know, putting my life on automatic as though it's some electric car that's supposed to know where it's going to go and it can drive all by itself. They all crash, and so do we. Let it function like the umpire in your heart. That's why this verse follows the words on forgiveness. It's a follow-up to forgiveness. It's saying, let his peace rule, and sometimes peace involves the forgiveness process. The peace of God is the active application of the person and work of Jesus to all of my life situations of conflict, distress, and uncertainty. But the gospel is real. Okay? God is real. Jesus is real. And if he is real, through him, let that rule in real ways in your life. If you want to live in the flesh instead of the gospel, then you'll spend most of your time in your family and church holding everyone else to your laws, resenting them, and you'll be hard to live with, and you'll be a threat to peace in your family and peace in the church. You won't be able to forgive. You won't be able to bear with others very easily. What will come easy for you if you live in the flesh is to point out the sins and the shortcomings of other people and be completely blind to your own. But if you live in the gospel, you see, it's possible for us to live in grace and for peace to function like an umpire, even if we disagree with the calls sometimes. We have Jesus who is ruling. You will be able to sow in peace, and through that, James 3:18, to raise a harvest of righteousness. Isn't it interesting that he kind of flips the, you know, the purity and peace of the church? He kind of flips it and he says, sowing in peace means there will be a harvest of righteousness. Now, does that mean that you'll always feel like you're at peace or that relationships would always be peaceful? No, not at all. Some of you are in conflicts right now. Some of you are in conflicts right now or situations where it's beyond your control. You can't control another person and what they're like. It's hard to control bullies. You might have to put your foot down and stick up for yourself. You might have to be very clever and outwit them, or maybe even avoid them if possible. Romans 12:18 says, if it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. Don't take revenge. Don't repay evil for evil. But live in peace. It's not always possible. Okay? So what do we do? We trust God. We trust God who is on his throne and who loves you and cares for you. Cast all your anxieties on him because he cares for you. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for the gospel and for the good news. We thank you that it's not just an intellectual experience, but that the living reality of Jesus in our lives is possible through your Son and the Holy Spirit whom he sent. May we be your people. May we be a people of peace. May we pursue it and make every effort. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I'd like to invite the elders who will be serving communion, if you would come forward at this time and just take a seat in the front row. It's always open seats in the front row. Just want to take just a moment to sort of explain functionally how we'll be celebrating the Lord's Supper, since we'll be doing it a little bit differently than the way that we have been over the last year or so. Tom and I will be on either side of the table here. We're going to invite all of you to come forward. We invite you to come forward down the two center aisles here to come to the front where Tom and I will be on either side. You have a few options. You can either, we will serve you bread, or if you prefer, the old-fashioned, it's funny to say old-fashioned now, it's just so 2020, the old-fashioned packets that we've all grown so accustomed to. Those are up here as well if you prefer those. If you need a gluten-free option, there is a plate here on the table with some gluten-free wafers, so you can choose that as well. But otherwise, Tom and I will be standing here. We will serve you with tongs so that we're not touching things. You can just hold out your hand and we'll plop it in there. And then an elder will be behind us to serve the cup as well. So you can just come down these center aisles, receive the bread and the cup, and then kind of return to your seats by going around on the wings. We also have a plate in the front here. That's for the deacon's offering, which we do once a month. The general fund offering is in the back, and then I know some of you like to do that as you come forward for the Lord's table, so that will be in the front here, which you can do after the service or whenever you prefer. I think I covered all the how-tos.
You don't all have to stand up all at once, and we're not going to direct you when to come to the table. You come when you're ready, but keep some distance out of respect for your neighbor as you kind of line up in the aisle.
Right. So as we come to the Lord's table, let's recall what this is about. In Jesus' day, to share a meal with someone was very significant. It meant that there was a sense of peace, a sense of fellowship between all the persons gathered at the table. It's a much more robust understanding of what it is to share a meal than what we commonly think of. But it means a lot. And so it's significant that the Lord came to his disciples on the last night and shared a meal with them. And then gave that as an ordinance and a sacrament to the church to be carried out for generations and generations and generations. And so this represents that we have communion with the Lord. It's the Lord's Supper. That we have peace with him. But also that it's a meal that we partake in together. We don't do the Lord's Supper by ourselves. We do it with God's people, signifying the communion that we have and the peace that we have among ourselves as well. It's a beautiful reminder of the gospel. We are at peace with God because of his broken body, because of his shed blood. That's symbolized here. So we partake in that. We receive and we experience the peace with God and peace with our fellow man. So we invite all those who've made a profession of faith, who you know the Lord as your Savior, and you come to this table, you come and be blessed and be refreshed at the Lord's table. Let's pray together. Oh Lord our God, we're thankful for the cross. We're thankful that your body was broken, your blood was shed. You were sacrificed on our behalf, that we might be forgiven of our sin and be made right with you, that we have peace with you, and we have peace with one another as well. Oh Lord, we thank you. Bless us now as we partake in the sacrament. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, and he said, "This is my body. It is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And in the same manner, he also took the cup. It was one cup. And he gave that cup to his disciples, and he said to them, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for the remission of sins. On want you all to eat of it, to drink of it.
Stop.
Is there anyone that needs to be served where you are sitting right now?
Let us pray. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Father, we have tasted. We know it's true. Your promises are sure. They have been displayed in front of us today. And we, in essence, have eaten of your promise to us. You've sealed yourself to your people. And so we just thank you for your grace. We thank you for your death, for your resurrection, for your ascension, and for your ruling from heaven over all this earth. Give us faith and trust in you each day and as we go forth from this time of worship together. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Our closing hymn you will see is there. We'll stand and we will sing that together. these words of peace if you'd extend your hands. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. You may be seated for just one moment.
You see on the back of your bulletin there, which we do encourage you to read through the whole bulletin, on the back of your bulletin's announcement for the youth group is doing a Move for Life, kind of like a Run for Life, to benefit Align Life Ministries, who was here last week sharing about the ministry that they do in our area. They are trying to raise some funds, so you can see the website there on the back of your bulletin. It's on the slide behind me. If you would like to sponsor them in that endeavor, that would be wonderful. So please take some time to look at that. Other than that, just a reminder that there is no Sunday school today, being the first Sunday of the month. We have Sunday school off. So it is a beautiful, wonderful day outside, I'm told. So let's go out there and experience God's goodness to us on this wonderful Lord's Day. Go in peace. You're dismissed. Mm-hmm.